are or where you might find yourself on life's journey, whether you are a believer, a doubter, or a seeker, you are welcome in this sacred space. And I am going to call on Jeanette to read our announcements. And
yeah, we'll start there.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Healing and find rescue souls, challenge and comfort alike, an inspiration to share Christ's love as you go forth in faith. Are you visiting us today? We encourage all guests to fill out the yellow visitor card located in the pews and place it in the offering plate. The HVAC repair final cost was $4,010. As of last week, we have raised $2,300. Vine's little free library has returned, and you can borrow a book. Remember, our coffee cup challenge is running through the end of the year. Camp Kaleo needs attention. The work weekend will be on September 16th through the 18th. Please see Mark Jager because he is in need of volunteers. Our branching out theme for August will be the open shelf food pantry at Connection Points. Please make a donation. Sunday school registration forms are due by August 31st. They are available in the back of the church. The Vine Garden, check it out in the fellowship hall after service. And finally, please shop script to support our church. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeanette. And are there any other announcements that we may have failed to call attention to? All right. I'd invite those who are able to stand as we begin our worship with our call to worship. Our God knows us intimately. Our God is holy. Our God will reassure. And I'd invite those who are standing and seated both to turn into your hymnal on page 382 as we sing our opening hymn, Come We Who Love God's Name.
Together God's great love proclaim, together.
we pray. Mother God, we rejoice that you placed us in the womb and called us forth. You called us forth to build and to plant. Give us the blueprint as we build and bless our hands as we plant. We rejoice in knowing that our steps are guided by you and you are reliable. We delight ourselves in your presence and give thanks as you deliver us from fear and let your love have its way in us. Embody us to speak your truth to power, and let the power of your truth always be evident in us. Amen. And you may be seated. And I am going to call up the children, and we're going to switch to people who are going to deliver the message.
I had a little mix-up on some emails this week. Yeah, all the kids could come up. Morning. Raise your hand if you play a sport. Play a sport? What sport do you play? Play volleyball? What sport do you play?
I just swim.
You swim? So in sports, there's rules, right? And the rules are there to keep people safe. But sometimes something can happen when you're playing a sport, and you have to, like if you're in a football game and somebody gets hurt, normally there's not people all over the field, right? But if somebody gets hurt, then all of a sudden everybody's out there trying to help. So that's kind of breaking the rules of the game. Does that make sense? A little bit? So on this, when our scripture story for today takes place, Jesus, there's certain rules that the Israelites were given about their day of worship called the Sabbath. And one of those rules was that they weren't supposed to work. So when Jesus saw a woman in the congregation who was hurt, he decided he better help her, and it was on the Sabbath. So the leader of the congregation became upset and told Jesus he had broken the rules because Jesus wanted to help her.
I see some people breaking
the rules. Yeah, I was just going to say, you have some rules up here? I don't know if we really do. But anyway, Jesus told the leader of the congregation that healing someone who was hurt was more important than the rules at that moment. So that, now doesn't that mean the Sabbath rules should always be ignored? No. But just like the rules in sport that are paused when someone gets hurt, Jesus showed us that some rules are true religious rules. He's had lots of energies. Anyways. So Jesus' words and actions are more are an important reminder that each and every one of us are more important to God than the rules are. And when we or someone we know is hurting, God wants us to pause the rules and share God's healing with those who are hurting. That's the good news for today. Let's say a prayer quickly, all right? You guys say after me. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
Who shows us.
Who shows us.
How you love us.
How you love us.
More than anything else.
More than anything else.
Help us love each other.
Help us love each other.
In the exact same way.
In the exact same way.
Amen.
Amen.
Right. Why can't everybody get paid?
Well, because that's one of the rules.
Thank you.
thank you very much for the Bellsummer piece and Beth for the, what was that, Old Clark? Old Joe Clark. Is there a story behind that?
Yeah.
What is the story of Old Joe Clark? That we know.
I don't know the whole story. No. Anybody else knows more?
I think we need some context here for the music. Okay, Russ.
Well, it's a kid's song that goes when that bomb comes out. In my corner glow, thought I saw a pretty girl say, yeah, here comes my bow.
Well, old Joe Clark.
Okay. So it's a love song. Okay. Thank you. Well, let us switch gears just a little bit here and take time for kind of a transformation and new life type of prayer. And let me read this and then I'll invite you into some silence. Shall we pray? Thanks, transforming God. Too often, we have been afraid to speak out against the injustices of this world. We have worshiped in ways that make us feel good rather than honor you in your words and deeds. Show us the path to faithful living. Show us how to build beloved and just communities. Teach us how to do your work in this world. Empower us to plant seeds of love, faith, and hope. May we bloom where we have been planted to your glory. Let us take now some time to reflect on these words and how they affect each of us. The mystery we name God leads us into all truth. Feel the gentle nudging without and within, helping us to course correct. Life in the Spirit is not static, and neither are we. Let the grace of God help us to build that which lasts and plant what nourishes.
This is not in the bulletin, but it is a special gift from the Bell Choir. Would you please join me in singing the first verse of What a Friend We Have in Jesus?
Thank you.
Our scripture reading for today is from Luke, chapter 10, verses 10 through 17. This is the Passion Translation. One Sabbath day, while Jesus was teaching in the synagogue, he encountered a seriously handicapped woman. She was crippled and had been doubled over for 18 years. Her condition was caused by a demonic spirit of bondage that had left her unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her condition, he called her over and gently laid his hands on her. Then he said, "Dear woman, you are free. I release you forever from this crippling spirit." Instantly she stood straight and tall and overflowed with glorious praise to God. The Jewish leader who was in charge of the synagogue was infuriated over Jesus' healing on the Sabbath day. "6 days you are to work," he shouted angrily at the crowd. "Those are the days you should come here for healing, but not on the Sabbath." The Lord said, "You are hopeless frauds. Don't you care for your animals on the Sabbath day? Untying your ox or donkey from the stall and leading it away for water? If you do this for your animals, what is wrong with allowing this beloved daughter of Abraham, who has been bound by Satan for 18 long years, to be untied and set free on a Sabbath day?" When they heard this, his critics were completely humiliated, but the crowd shouted with joy over the glorious things Jesus was doing among them. This is the scripture for today. May we hear the word of God in it for us.
I invite those who are able to stand as we sing our next song, Christian Rise and Act Your Creed, which is found on page 537 in your hymnal. Well, today's story is simple enough. Jesus is now working his way towards Jerusalem, and he stops on a Sabbath to speak at a local synagogue. And while there, he notices a woman who is so bent over, so afflicted that she could not look up, but could see only was around her feet in front of her. Jesus, filled with compassion, heals her, violating the blue laws of not working on the Sabbath, and once again gets in trouble with the local religious authority. Jesus' healing on the Sabbath is nothing new in the Gospel of Luke. In the first 12 chapters of Jesus' ministry in Luke, Jesus, in a variety of contexts, has been challenging the limited perspective of what the Sabbath is about. The religious leaders of the day see the Sabbath as a day of rest, therefore believe that any work was violating the intention of what Sabbath is. Jesus, on the other hand, sees Sabbath as a day of healing. To Jesus, the idea of Sabbath was to restore both the body and the soul. Therefore, healing can also be thought of as a day of restoration. Now, there's common agreement amongst our society that Sunday is this day set aside to focus on God things. We loosely refer to that as the Sabbath. On that day, most church attendees spend an hour to worship, sing a few songs of praise, give some time to prayer, listen to scripture, and on occasion, listen to what the pastor has to say. So my beginning questions are these. What do you expect to receive from this hour? When you come to worship, what do you expect to receive in this hour? What are you looking for when you come to worship? Do you think of Sundays as your Sabbath? And if so, does your expectation of Sabbath include restoration? The story of a woman who was so crippled that she could not look up is in the middle of a larger story that the author of Luke's Gospel is sharing with us. There is this progression in which this morning's story gains its meaning. So this story is flanked by two stories. The first story speaks about the need of repentance. As Jesus uses the incident of some Galilean worshipers who were killed by Roman soldiers during their period of worship, and then also included in that the example of how 18 people who were seeking healing at the Pool of Siloam were killed when the wall fell down and killed them, and yet let others live. His point to this group was to dispute the idea that those who died were worse sinners than those who were still alive, but that all of us are in need of repentance. Then comes our story of this woman who was so bent over, and with compassion, Jesus heals her, and she stands upright. From there, the writer moves and follows up with a parable that addresses restoration. As Jesus uses the example of the mustard seed to describe God's kingdom as providing shelter and rest. Presented is the idea of the need of repentance. And out of repentance comes that healing. And from healing, once that has happened, then restoration begins. Now, the cause of the woman's affliction is described as a hold of Satan. I understand this to describe a brokenness between the woman's reality and God's intention for her. When Jesus touches her, he says, "Woman, you are free. You are now released from this crippling spirit." So whatever the brokenness was, she is now healed, being restored in her restored in her life. For you see, culturally, she was excluded from society because she was viewed as being possessed by an unclean spirit. And this also meant that she was excluded from entering into the synagogue. She, in essence, was denied access to the source of healing that was expected to take place in an established sacred space. Her restoration went beyond her physical abilities to stand upright. She was now able to re-enter inside of you. So figuratively speaking, how many of us go through our day bent over, feeling weighed down and limited? How many of us are so weighed down to a point that makes us feel that we do not deserve to be included? What things in our lives try to prevent us from being able to stand upright? Maybe it's the years of crushing physical or emotional pain, or an illness that is life-altering or even life-threatening. Maybe it's a loss of work or a severed relationship. Maybe it's the experience of being marginalized because we're different. As Jesus says to the religious leader, is not our priority that of to do good, to heal no matter the day or time? Jesus does not recognize a set time for healing or of restoration when he announced his ministry, as early in chapter 4 of Luke, when he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he has anointed me to be hope to the poor, healing for the brokenhearted, and new eyes for the blind, and to preach to prisoners, you are set free. Jesus doesn't mention any specific office hours to be doing this kind of work. If life were only so simple that our mind and our heart walk in unity, would you agree? Wouldn't life be so much simpler if our heart and our mind walked in unity? Back in the 1980s, as the AIDS crisis was increasing, and we knew very little about the disease, people who were HIV positive were truly the lepers of our time. I happened to have the privilege to go to a convocation that focused on ministering people living with AIDS, which opened the opportunity then to work as a religious voice for two county health departments in Washington State, as they were trying to educate professionals who would potentially be treating in the future their clients who would be HIV positive and or AIDS diagnosed. So because of my connections within the community I was serving, I was aware of several people who were living with not just HIV, but at AIDS diagnosis, which meant that they were very sick people, but it also meant these people were truly being ostracized by society. Well, one evening, as I was sitting in the hot tub of the city recreational facility, which was something I did quite frequently, I started wondering to myself, what would I do if a person with AIDS got into the hot tub while I was there? I didn't have long to find out, because it just seemed like the door opened up and enters a young man who was diagnosed with AIDS, and he got into the hot tub with me. My first reaction was to just jump out of the water right then and there. Even though I had had head knowledge about this terrible disease, my emotional fear and my rational brain hadn't yet come into agreement. Well, I forced myself to stay seated in the hot tub and visited with this individual, and eventually I was able to move beyond my irrational fear into my new understanding of how this virus works, creating a common sacred ground between us from that hot tub. Now, although no physical healing was possible at that time for this person, restoration was experienced through a sense of community between two people. For I too received a restoration encounter. It wasn't just the person who was sick with restoration, but it was also the person who was extending this hand for fellowship and ministry. It is my prayer that each time we come to worship, we come with expectations of finding restoration in our lives. It may be found within our physical situation, or it may be found within our spiritual realm of our being. The one thing that this morning's scripture text can assure us of is this. Whatever situations that try to keep us from standing upright in life, there is healing and restoration available. And my prayer also is that this community of faith provides the space needed for that process of restoration. No matter who we are, or what needed, or what needs healing, that we allow that space for it to happen each Sunday when we come into God's sacred space here. Amen. At this point, I would like to lift up prayers of the people. And it is a time for us to think of those who are in particular need of restoration and healing. And feel free to call out that name, and in response we will reply with, "Hear our prayer, O Lord." And it is also a time where we are able to express joy as well. And at that, we will reply, "Thanks be to God." Loving God, we thank you for stories that we read in Scripture of how Jesus is able to just reach out and touch someone, and they seem to have been healed instantly. But we also know that as a community, we too need that healing so that restoration continues to happen, not just here amongst our own people, but throughout our community and worldwide. And at this time, I would like us to continue to pray for Jessica as she is dealing with her cancer treatments. And shall we pray? "Hear our prayer, O Lord." And I'd like us to uphold Kathy, who's a sister of one of our online Facebook followers. Shall we pray? "Hear our prayer, O Lord." I'd also like to pray for safe travels for our people who are out traveling, either in the continental U.S. or outside of the country. Shall we pray? "Hear our prayer, O Lord." What other concerns or joys are we bringing this morning?
My colleague, Shannon, whose family is dealing with
let us hold Shannon in prayer and his family as they are going through this troubled time. Shall we pray? "Hear our prayer, O Lord."
First, I have joy. Last weekend, Rick and I were able to travel to my mom and celebrate her 90th birthday, and many of our cousins and extended family members from all across the country were able to make it, and we had a very nice long weekend celebrating that.
So let us give thanks for a wonderful weekend of celebrating life with parents and extended family. Shall we pray? Thanks be to God.
The second part of that is, while we were there, my mom got a diagnosis that she had as cancer. It's a very large, very aggressive tumor. And she's having a biopsy tomorrow to see exactly the extent of it. But right before we went to her birthday, the doctor said, "If you want to see mom, you need to come now." So that's a tough bit another 90.
So let us hold Jim's mother in prayer as she is dealing with this diagnosis of cancer. Shall we pray?
Hear our prayer, Lord.
Co-worker of mine, Aaron, suddenly lost his father this past week, so it was quite a shock.
Let us hold co-worker Aaron and the family in prayer as they are going through this adjustment and the loss of their family member. Shall we pray?
Hear our prayer, O Lord.
For my brother-in-law Sylvester, who's been sick for a little bit, and he should be on the road to recovery.
So, are we going to be doing a joy or continuing?
A joy.
Okay, so a joy with Sylvester, who's on the road to recovery. Shall we pray? Thanks be to God. I hope you realize that as we pray publicly like this, that we are sending all sorts of energy out into the universe so that God can use that energy within the lives of the people that we are picking up specifically. Any other prayer or joys? Join with me then the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The divine source is the one from whom all blessings flow. And we have an eternal invitation to bring our resources to God's house to use for the building of the kingdom, and as seed that there might be a continual harvest. These acts reflect the God who knows us and the God who calls us.
Thank you.
love, faith,